Bună ziua, bine ați venit la ediția din luna august a seminarului de cercetare al Băncii Naționale, BERS. Am decalat puțin și din cauza concediilor momentul seminarului și având în vedere și topicul pe care o să-l abordeze și Cătălin, cred că ne-am sincronizat destul de bine cu evenimentele care au loc și în România la momentul acesta. Invitatul de astăzi este Cătălin Dragomirescu Găină. Aș începe prezentarea lui prin a spune că am avut plăcerea și eu și colegii din direcție să-l avem coleg. De fapt, noi am devenit colegii lui. El a fost printre primii care au fost economiști în cadrul Direcției Modelare și Prognoze Macroeconomice timp de 8 ani, nu, Cătălin?
Cam 8, da.
2004-2012. Ulterior a lucrat la Centrul de Cercetare al Comisiei Europene din ISPRA, din Italia. Iar acum este profesor asociat al Universității Catolice.
Asistent.
Nu știu exact cum e clasificarea în Italia relativ la ce în România, relativ la ce în Statele Unite, în fin. Okay. Asistent al Universității din Catolice Sacro Cuore din Milano. Ai avut colaborări, Cătălin, în ce văd aici, și cu Universitatea din Milano și cu școala de management al
Business School din
Angers, cu locație în Paris la momentul acesta. Doctoratul este obținut de la aceeași universitate, Universitatea Catolică de Sacro Cuore din Milano. Publicațiile sunt pe domenii asociate în general macroeconomiei și vorbim de publicații în jurnale precum Economic Letters, International Review of Financial Analysis, Journal of International Money and Finance, Journal of Policy Modeling. Lucrarea pe care o să o vedem astăzi vorbește despre Uncertainty Spillovers when Policy and Financial Realms Overlap. Aș vrea să-ți mulțumesc, Cătălin, pentru faptul că ai acceptat invitația noastră. Eu personal chiar am emoții și mă bucur foarte mult să te revăd și în postura asta și mulțumim încă o dată.
Cu plăcere. Mulțumesc și eu de invitație. Sper să găsiți lucrarea aceasta interesantă. E un paper la care lucrăm cam de aproximativ 2 ani, cred. Și sperăm să îl publicăm într-un jurnal bun. Bine, asta depinde și de cât feedback pozitiv sau negativ obținem în următoarele câteva luni, cât mai dorim să lucrăm la acest paper. O să vedeți astăzi, o să vă vorbesc, o să prezint paperul în engleză și o să fac trimitere din când în când la anumite încercări și anumite lucruri pe care încercăm să le schimbăm față de versiunea working paper care e acum disponibilă pe internet. Am primit deci feedback la diverse conferințe și încercăm să integrăm acest feedback în paper la momentul actual. Prin urmare, ceea ce o să prezint e cumva versiunea de acum câteva luni. Și o să fac, cum spuneam, referire la părțile care eventual se schimbă și cum se schimbă în funcție de feedback pe care l-am primit. Ok. Să începem. O să dau share. Ok. Se vede, sper. Da?
Da.
Okay, so this paper is a joint paper with Emanuele Bacciocchi from University of Bologna. And it's titled Uncertainty Spillovers, When Policy and Financial Realms Overlap. I just put this picture with the iconic image of Davos, a little town in Switzerland where every year for the last at least 50 years, there's been this World Economic Forum where we all know that policymakers and bankers and entrepreneurs and investors mingle, meet, and speak to each other. So basically, this picture is just, I took it as an example of places and events where we have this policy realm overlapping with the financial realm, because all these people sometimes move from one realm into the other one. Draghi, for example, was working in the private sector, and then he moved to become basically the governor of the European Central Bank. So, I could give plenty of examples, and I'm sure that you know, of many people who moved between these two worlds, the finance world and the policy world. So I think that, and the paper basically starts with this nice introduction, I guess, describing that in reality, we can have a lot of different overlaps between the two worlds. Now, the problem is that in empirical papers, in empirical applications, these type of overlaps create identification problems. And we're going to see what kind of type of identification problems, what kind of type of identification problems these might lead to. Okay, so moving on. I took these two graphs from a paper by Farhi and Tirol, 2017. A review of economic studies, where basically, and I'm sure that you all know the stories, what happened in Ireland and what happened in Greece. They both ended up getting money from Troika, but somehow the order of the events and the order, the trigger of the shock was different. In Ireland, right, we had the financial, we had the banks, the financial sector that was the source of the initial shock, which then spread to the sovereign, or if you want, to the policy world. We see basically here that in sometimes in 2008, Ireland announced that banks will be bailed out by the government. So then basically investors understood that the risks are transferred from the financial sector to the policy sector, to the government, right? So we see these kind of, it was the CDS which were rising, and then just after, and no impact on the sovereign CDS, but then once the government bails out the banks, we see both of them climbing. In Greece, on the other hand, it was the other way around. So there were it all started with the Greece government acknowledging that they had some issues with statistical data and statistical reporting about the national debt. And then somehow we see that basically here the sovereign CDS, the sovereign risk was high, and then somehow this risk moved into the financial sector as well, once then the government started to impose different capital controls and so on. So the main point here is that while the order of the shocks, okay? And the origin of the shock was different. These two stories are well known. So there has been a lot of research about Ireland and about Greece, and we all know what happened. But what if we don't know a priori what happened and where the shock originates first, okay? So basically this represents the motivation of the paper. We try to develop and kind of create and add to the existing stock of identification methods by proposing this type of identification of two types of uncertainty shocks. So there is no need for you to know where the shock, the uncertainty shock originates. Does it originate in the financial sector, or does it originate in the policy sector, in the sovereign realm? So there is no need for any a priori knowledge about where of where the shock originates. And we're going to show that basically this kind of approach is quite successful in identifying various periods of uncertainty. Because in the end, we're going to run some kind of back testing, or if you want, we're going to try to identify whether we can associate the story with a particular shock for a particular time in a particular country. So to sum up, the motivation of the paper is that we try to kind of offer a solution to various identification issues when people and researchers are trying to identify two types of shocks, which are quite similar. Uncertainty stemming from the financial realm or stemming from the policy realm. Now, the problem is complicated because we want to do that in Europe. And the story in Europe is complicated because we have this multi-country perspective where with an kind of incomplete institutional architecture of the euro area, we all know that this institutional architecture is incomplete. We only have the European Central Bank. It's like the most powerful institution. On the other hand, there is no common treasury. There is no common deposit, bank deposit insurance. There are many elements missing. And we need to go a long way until Europe becomes a fully fledged federation or whatever. So at the moment, it's just the European Central Bank, which seems to be acting as a main leader in trying to stem uncertainty, right? So the research questions are, did ACB played any role in kind of, because it was the only institution with tools and with strength and power to address various types of uncertainty over the last 10, 20 years. And then the second research question is whether we can find some kind of amplification mechanism. So whether one type of uncertainty, like financial uncertainty, is more amplified because of this incomplete institutional architecture, or is it the other one? I mean, which shock spreads faster? Is it the financial uncertainty shocks that move from one country to all the other? Or is the policy uncertainty shock that moves from one country to the others? And we all remember, for example, the snap Greek referendum in 2015, when everyone started to question the future of the euro area. So, like, I can go on and give various examples from the last 10 years where we've seen either financial shocks spreading from one country or policy uncertainty shocks spreading to all the other countries. So we try to see which one spreads faster, whether there are some kind of types of amplification mechanism. And yeah, I mean, these are the two main questions we are trying to address in the paper. Theoretical background, there is no clear, first of all, there is no clear theoretical background for a paper like that. And one of the comments we received was that the paper is missing this kind of theoretical background, and because that would help people to understand, those people who do not have, let's say, who are not interested so much in empirical work. So unfortunately, the paper probably is going to remain like that without a theoretical background. But here I'm just going to, give some kind of ingredients about what kind of theoretical background we are using to support the paper. So in a single country settings, we have many papers and many theoretical papers discussing this sovereign banks nexus, where the main mechanism is that banks hold sovereign bonds and the government, the local government, somehow provides implicit guarantees for the banks. So the local government is kind of basically promising local banks that if they buy enough bonds, they're gonna be bailed out. So this is the main mechanism, different models. And then in a multi-country settings, instead, this kind of sovereign bank nexus doesn't work anymore. And this is the case for euro area. We all know that somehow the Italian banks ended up buying a lot of Italian sovereign bonds, and French banks did the same, Greek banks did the same. To some extent, approach can be, what we are trying to use as the backbone of our paper is that information frictions play the central role in a multi-country settings. Why? Because it's much easier in theory for investors, if they are local investors, to understand what type of uncertainty they have to face. So, to simplify things, French investors will pretty much know more and will have more insights of whether, for example, the French government is willing and able to bail out French banks compared to Italian investors, for example, or other international investors. So, there is some kind of information remains locally bounded. And in order for the information to cross borders, there are frictions. It's not just language, or it's also about the insights. It's about the rumors, if you want, okay? So if you want to kind of throw this discussion in a we can even say that French investors have access to local rumors much more often than foreign investors. So they understand the commitment of local governments in bailing out the local banks. Moving on. Data and modeling approach. We are using a sample of 15 euro area countries, 6 other EU countries. Unfortunately, Romania is out of the sample, but we have some kind of proxies like Hungary and Poland and the Baltics, which are aggregated as a one single country. Then we have 4 non-European Union neighbors like Russia, Turkey, Switzerland. We have US. And the sample runs from 2003 to 2018 on a monthly frequency. As endogenous variables, we are using 3 variables. We are using the 10-year sovereign yield spreads against Germany. We are working now, and we have a version of the model using just 10-year sovereign yields rather than spreads. So the paper I'm going to show you now, so the working version, the working paper version is using spreads together with 2 uncertainty proxies. One is the well-known Economic Policy Uncertainty, or EPU, by Baker and his co-authors, 2015 Quarterly Journal of Economics, which basically is an indicator, composite indicator, which is based on the frequency of some keywords that reflect discussion in the media about changes in economic policies, about opinions, about well, what kind of discussions are ongoing and whether the government is suffering or is on the verge of a political crisis, like, for example, what you are having right now in Romania. So probably if I were to kind of track the number, the times and the frequency of some keywords which are related to policy, uncertainty, economic measures, I'm going to probably find now for September a spike, right? So this indicator captures uncertainty in the policy realm. The second indicator is a so-called composite indicator of systemic stress, or KIS, and is a composite indicator, again, that reflects systemic stress in different segments of the financial market, so in different countries. Okay, so we are talking about the government bonds, about equities, about spreads, yields, about so various corners, various segments of the financial market, and this indicator captures this kind of common component, which is called financial stress. This relies on volatility, relies on, if you want, market data, which is different, entirely different compared to the first indicator, which relies on the frequency of keywords. So it's about media coverage. EPU is about media coverage. Well, the second indicator is about some kind of traded measures, volatility, some kind of market-based measures of risk. So we take the two proxies are as basically reflecting uncertainty in the financial and in the policy realms. I'm going to show you some correlations, both across time and across countries. And you will see that besides this kind of conceptual overlap, that they are kind of both of them trying to measure uncertainty or uncertainty and risk, if you want to make this difference. But we are not actually making this difference. There are like stark differences in terms of method and data collection. So the two indicators are completely different. But in reality, there is a high correlation between them. I'm going to show you how. And we are using a GVAR modeling setup. I'm going to come back to this later. So,
Cătălin,
first, yes.
O întrebare, se poate?
Yes.
Can you go back to the previous slide?
Yes.
So, when you are saying that you are using these two measures and they're proxying one for policy uncertainty and the other one for like financial sector uncertainty, isn't it a bit too strong statement to say this? Because if I'm looking at the first one, probably, as you are saying, it's highly correlated with the second one and they have a like common factor behind them, which is probably related to more like to...
There might, yes, Mihai, there might be some kind of common component, but if you want, I can make a difference between uncertainty and risk. And I can say that first one, EPU, is more likely a measure of uncertainty about what the government is going to do next, whether the government is confident to adopt some kind of policy initiative or something. Well, the second one is a market-based composite indicator of market-based indicators like volatility, second
exactly.
Moment, some data. So although I put their high correlation up to 0.5, so 0.5, yes, it's high, but sometimes can be as low as 0.2, right? And mostly I'm going to show you that these correlations are not consistent over time. So Let me go to this
Because
slide.
what I'm trying to say more exactly is like the second measure is based on some actual developments in like financial sector variables, and you see it like more as a, as you are saying, like a risk measure that comes from a certain PDF function that you know about. And the first one is like uncertainty related, where you don't know the exact distribution, and it refers to some future events from an unknown PDF that you are not aware of.
Right, exactly. Can be thought in this way, can be seen in this perspective. But let me go through this slide and the next one. And let me say just that the correlations you are seeing here between the two measures at country level. So for Italy, for example, we have 0.46, 42, 45, 40, 36. As we go back and forth, right, leads and lags between the two. So to some extent, the two uncertainty measures are quite correlated. If I change, this is for the full sample, 2003-2018, but if I change and focus on 2008-2013 or anything, these correlations will change a lot, okay? So they are not robust, which means that the link between and the overlaps between the two measures, it depends on something which we don't know, right? If it's like what you were saying, like there is a common risk uncertainty, well, sometimes they kind of overlap completely, and sometimes they are just different. Okay, this is what I'm trying to say. For France here, and I did not put for Sweden, for example. In Sweden, they are not so much significant. France here, you see that KIS, 2 months before, it's not correlated with EPU now. It's correlated for the future, but not for the past. So again, these correlations are not robust, and I do not know how to present them, but just that, you know, they are not robust. If I change the sample, if I change the countries, I can see bigger, lower numbers, insignificant numbers, or very significant numbers. So it means that there is some kind of process that makes these two variables either reflect the same underlying event, either being contaminated one by another one, or being completely separated one by another one, by another. So basically reflecting two different phenomena, right? Now, let me go also to this one where we have the cross-country correlations. Here you see that the correlations are a little bit bigger and statistically significant. So 0.7, 0.2 here, right? This is EPU with EPU across countries. So for example, this is how EPU in France is correlated with EPU in all the other countries. And this is how KIS in France is correlated with KIS in all the other countries. So quite highly correlated. These are a little bit more stable and more robust, right? So to some extent, if there is a common policy uncertainty phenomena or event, this event spreads quite fast, and it drives all the countries together, right? Same for KIS. So if there is a financial stress event somewhere in some country of the euro area, then it spreads quite fast within the same month. Okay, these are contemporaneous correlations. You see here KIS T with KIS at time T. So it spreads quite fast to other countries. So there is a lot of you know, commonality between these variables across countries. While this table here, again, the correlations are not so robust. So there might be some event which makes sometimes for some periods where I have significant correlations between the two, which means that they are somehow affected by the same event, or some other time in some other country, there might be completely uncorrelated, meaning that they are driven by two different phenomena, right? So this is what we are trying to understand also. Okay, I hope to some extent I kind of answered to your to your question before, it's an imperfect way of proxying the two events. Okay, if you want, we are like constrained. We chose the title, and then we chose the data. So to some extent, we want to frame the story as we frame it. Okay.
Yeah.
Of course, that I can use some kind of other proxy for policy uncertainty and perhaps other proxy for keys, but I think that these are the two most common uncertainty measures. And keys, by the way, is a policy relevant financial indicator. It's not that it's just any. The European Central Bank is using it.
Yeah. One more question then. If you're looking at this forecasters disagreement uncertainty related measure, yeah?
Yeah.
How would you define that? Policy related or financials? So you have the.
Yes, tell me.
You have the forecasts of on different variables of individual forecasters, and you are looking at the dispersion of those forecasts. You can build up a measure of uncertainty that results from the dispersion of those forecasts.
Right, exactly.
That would be. And you have that macro and you have financial variables. How would you put that? How would you define in your context that measure? Would you put it as a policy or financial sector?
Exactly. That would be macro. That would be like adding both, you know, aggregating both of these measures.
Okay.
You
know? Okay.
Because to some extent, the analysts will be like forward looking and taking into account current policy uncertainty. If they see that the government is unclear or unsure about whether adopting some measure or not, and for sure they know what's going on in the financial market, so to some extent they are incorporating both of them, right?
Okay.
So yeah. this is also because this is the first paper that is trying to disentangle two types of uncertainty. Of course you can have three. Okay, there are other papers where they are trying to identify uncertainty in general, but they're going to be using EPU and instrumented with KISS, for example. Or they're going to use KISS as an uncertainty proxy and they're going to instrument it with EPU. We are not doing that. Okay, we are just putting both types of uncertainty. And for sure, you can have, for example, right now, you can have health-related uncertainty, whether, you know, about the virus, about a new variant spreading across the world, like Delta, Gamma, Mu, whatever, you know? So you can basically have different uncertainty measures coming from different areas. So how, then the question is, coming back to the original research question, how can you disentangle between these two, three, four uncertainty types and somehow keep have a reliable and robust results and conclusion that can be matched by the facts? You know, this is what we are trying to provide.
Okay, thank you.
Now, the GVAR specification is basically what I told you, that there are like three endogenous variables for European countries. So I'm going to have 10-year yield spreads, EPU and KISS for each country. Of course, some countries might be missing this EPU, like Hungary, like Poland. Not all the countries have it, but all countries have KISS in Europe. Okay, so the European Central Bank is computing a measure of KISS for all countries, not for Russia, not for Turkey, of course, but for all the other European countries, yes. So we have these endogenous VAR type of specification for each country. And the trick in a GVAR is just to add this star variables or foreign specific variables, which are basically weighted averages of all the other countries. So for example, if this is Italy, so the endogenous variables in Italy will also depend on a weighted average of all the endogenous variables in all other countries except Italy. Now, because we want to focus on the euro area, these other countries for Italy will be actually only the euro area countries. Okay, so to some extent, I'm kind of forcing these foreign influences to only to come from other euro area countries rather than from Russia or whatever. Okay, so to some extent we are using so many countries like Turkey, like Russia, like US in order to clean our system from all these possible possible impacts that are coming from outside. Russia had the problem with Crimea, right? So there was some kind of uncertainty ongoing there. I wanted to clean my data from this possible external influences, which are not actually related to the euro area, and then stick to the euro area, concentrate on the euro area. Now, this is the unrestricted specification, and there is also a restricted specification where these C coefficients are set to zero, and basically the system is re-estimated. Okay, and there are some global variables which in our case and are encompassing ACB policies or ACB, they are like a proxy for ACB. And these X variables are modeled as a simple VAR with, again, with an exogenous component here, which are basically the endogenous variables that come from other countries. So I'm going to give you some details about what we use later for ACB, how we proxy the ACB. We're going to use three proxy for ACB, which are basically conventional monetary policy proxy, liquidity proxy, and unconventional monetary policy proxy. Now, in the GVAR, the trick is that you have to exogenize somehow the weights. So how you aggregate external influences. We are using two types of weights. These weights are in the baseline based on portfolio exposures, which are more stable over time. As a robustness, we are using cross-border banking exposures from BIS. Okay. They are a little bit more tricky, and we all know that banks move capital between countries. The things changed after the financial crisis from 2008-2009, and there was a lot of volatility there. So portfolio exposures are a little bit more more stable over time. Think about that we're using a sample from 2003 to 2018. So you can somehow separate the sample into three periods if you want, you know, before 2008, then before 2012, 13, even 15 maybe, when the Greek crisis was on the, you know, at its peak, and then up to 2018 when it was again a calm period. So the idea behind using this weight is that somehow then the model would be a kind of a representation of the international portfolio rebalancing channel. So the investors are kind of watching risk measures and uncertainty measures between countries, and then they select optimally the weights of different country-specific assets. And then they rebalance these portfolios based on these endogenous uncertainty measures, based on returns and based on risk. So it's like a risk return. Think about that we have the yields and uncertainty proxies. Now we are doing piecewise identification, and this is where we get to identification. We are using absolute magnitude restrictions, as in this paper by DeSantis and Zimek, Journal of Applied Econometrics. To cut the long story short, absolute magnitude restrictions are kind of a general form of restriction where you somehow impose that one shock is the biggest shock in the system. Okay, so if I want to identify a policy uncertainty shock, somehow I'm imposing restrictions such as to identify that shock to be the biggest shock in the system, in standard deviation terms, of course. So it's the biggest in terms of standard deviation from the whole system. So I'm not forcing my restrictions to be valid within a country, but just across the whole system, Right? So if I want to identify a policy uncertainty shock in Italy, that shock at that moment must be the biggest in the system. Not only in Italy, but across the whole system, which means also across all possibly similar type of uncertainty shocks in other countries. Because we've seen that there is a lot of common, there is a strong common component across EPU, across KIS, and also across yields, right? So the GVAR is quite successful in kind of removing these kind of common components in the endogenous variables. That's why we are using a GVAR, and that's why we are not afraid of using EPU or KIS or even yields, although they are driven by a common component, all of them, right? We are not afraid of that because once we are estimating our GVAR and we are looking at the residuals are not, the autocorrelation and the cross-correlation is very low compared to the correlation we've seen in our data. So to some extent, we are able with the GVAR to remove this commonality in terms of the endogenous variables. So this is quite good because this allows us to claim we are identifying country-specific shocks. Otherwise, it would be very hard to say because EPU in France might be influenced by policy uncertainty in Italy or in Germany, right? Because of, I don't know, media is reflecting events in Germany or whatever, right? We know, for example, that ACB had to stand legal challenges in Germany when it was trying to implement its quantitative easing policies. The German court kind of tried to challenge ACB. So as you can understand, this kind of type of uncertainty was reflected elsewhere, although to some extent it was particularly related to Germany, but it was reflected in other countries of the euro area because it was a euro area, a broader phenomenon. So this is a lot like technical details behind how the identification works. We start with the Cholesky decomposition of the reduced form variance covariance, and then we kind of rotate it. A bit tricky because we have to find those rotations that satisfy the restrictions, and there are many restrictions because there are many countries, and I want to make sure that my shock is the biggest one in the system. So there are like kind of 50 restrictions to be satisfied at each moment. So let me talk a little bit about the advantages and then we move straight to the results. This method is feasible and flexible in a multi-country setting, despite having to deal with a lot of restrictions. It's a new type of identification compared to what you have so far in the literature. You can identify two or even more uncertainty shocks in the same time. There is no instrument required to identify one type of uncertainty, like other papers I was saying are doing, trying to identify financial uncertainty using policy uncertainty as an instrument. We are not doing that. It would be hard to find two different instruments for our two types of uncertainty. There is no time precedence imposed anywhere, so there is no Cholesky decomposition available in our case. We've seen that for Greece and Ireland, the stories were quite different and the origin of the shock was quite different. So in general, we don't know what kind of shocks we are dealing with and what is the story behind that shock. Basically, these magnitude restrictions are a general form of, if you want, sine or zero restrictions, okay? The identification can be checked with validated using event study methods at the end, ex post. Okay, so let me now move to the results. I put here some kind of a short table where you see Italy. Let's take Italy. We see the observed response domestic, when we have a KISS shock and we are looking at the KISS responses, EPU responses to a KISS shock, KISS responses to a EPU shock, and EPU responses to a EPU shock here. Domestic, cross-border, what you see across different countries is that, of course, usually KISS responds to KISS shocks both domestically and cross-border. So the first column here usually includes significant responses for at least 6, 9, 12 months. The same with the last column, where we see that EPU responses to a country-specific EPU. Okay, usually you see both domestic and cross-border significant responses for some time. What you don't see is that you have some kind of insignificant here responses when you have this kind of cross responses, EPU responding to a KISS shock. So domestically, you see insignificant responses. See, it's like, except here a little bit for Greece, usually you see insignificant responses. This is in contrast with what you see for cross-border. So the intuition of this is that somehow these magnitude restrictions, although they are imposed on the full system, they are somehow successful in identifying one shock in the country. So domestically, I'm going to have one shock identified better than the other one. The response of the other one will be like insignificant, right? This is not so case. It's not the case when we have this cross-border responses. So you see here that in the columns in the middle, we have many insignificant responses. So I think this is different. This is interesting because I'm not imposing any particular restrictions to hold within Italy. So when I'm trying to split EPU from KISS shocks, I'm not imposing any additional restriction within Italy. So I'm not trying to impose, you know, that EPU shock is the biggest compared to the other shock in Italy. No, I'm just imposing them across the system. But somehow in other countries, I end up with significant EPU responses to an Italian KISS shock. So there it means that outside there is some kind of amplification ongoing. This kind of amplification is not happening here in Italy, right? So my EPU is, Italian EPU is not responding to an Italian KISS shock. So much, right? So somehow I'm kind of able to separate them. But outside the country, the foreign EPUs are responding to an Italian KISS shock significantly. Right, so there is some kind of amplification mechanism ongoing when I'm looking at one variable, although the shock was originating in the other one. Okay, so to get intuition of this is that outside the country, you get some kind of amplification and some kind of a dilution effect, so things become more mixed a little bit. You know, it's like outside, both variables respond, although the shock is quite clear that it was a financial shock, right? So it was quite clear that it was a financial shock in Italy, but somehow outside people don't know what to understand. Was it like policy or finance, you know? So then that's why you see this kind of significant reactions here. And weekly here, not so much here, but again, you see something happening in other countries as well here. So we're going to get the same intuition when we are looking at the decomposition of median peak impulse response functions. So usually the peak happens within 1 to 3 months. So when we are trying to decompose, I hope you can see this kind of gray color. When we are trying to decompose the peak impulse response, peak impulse responses, here you have KISS responses to an Italian KISS shock. And down here you have EPU responses to an Italian EPU shock. But here on the second diagonal, you have KISS responses to an Italian EPU shock. So it's the cross, the interaction, if you want, between the two uncertainty shocks. And you see a lot of black here, a lot of black contribution. And this black is actually measuring the contribution of spillovers. So what the model has in the data, what there is in the data, and I'm able to separate with my model. So when I'm doing the unrestricted versus the restricted specification, this is the spillover contribution. When I allow these foreign influences to come in my country and basically show their impact. So this is quite standard when you do, you know, to work with the restricted and unrestricted specification of the model and to compute these spillovers in this way. This is quite standard using this type of model. So I'm trying to basically show you that here, the spillovers contribute more than direct effects to explain KISS responses to EPU. And EPU responses to KISS shocks. You see here these two graphs here. This is for Italy. The second result is that, again, we see this kind of amplification mechanism because in Italy, the spillovers as a contribution are much smaller than in other countries. Okay, so this is basically in line with what we saw in the table before. This is again what we see happening with EPU in Italy, although the shock was a KISS shock in Italy. So the model does not amplify that shock that much. It amplifies that shock more in other countries, but not so much in Italy. So why in other countries, you know? And why here? The same thing happens for France, for example. You see a lot of black here and down here. And again, the same amplification works here. As a share in the total peak impulse response, the black is much smaller than what you see for Germany, for Italy, for Portugal, for example, here. Also here for Spain, right? If you are to compute the percentage share of how much the spillovers contribute, right? So to some extent, this was to be expected because in the long run, the spillovers will take over, right? And they will be dominating the spillovers. They will be dominating the impulse responses. So what happens to any variable in the model will be kind of 100% determined in the long run by spillovers because the model amplifies, because like basically linking my domestic variables with foreign variables, I get this kind of a better, the model is better able to explain my data, right? So the spillovers will be dominating in the long run. So if I'm doing these figures, not at the peak response, impulse response, but I'm doing it like for 24 months ahead, you're going to see a lot of black everywhere. Okay, so there's going to be a lot of black because the spillovers are basically dominating the influence. So if you want, the spillovers are dominating in terms of also in terms of variance decomposition, if you want, right? So to some extent, this is to be expected, right? But looking at such a short time horizon, I'm looking at the median peak. So basically we are talking about 1 month, 2 months, 3 months at most. It's kind of surprising to see that we can make this kind of judgments across different countries. Yes, across different countries and across different specifications and robustness checks. So these findings hold. There are many results. So sometimes you get lost by looking at so many results. So that's why you have to look for those which are robust and consistent across different specifications. For example, I can show you here that you will see that the peak happens no matter what impulse responses we are looking, the peak happens within 3 months from impact, right? So we are talking about a very short time horizon in these decompositions here, back here. This is all, again, just to see how they look like. Again, many data and many impulse responses to look. Unfortunately, we cannot do various decomposition because we are not identifying all the shocks in the same time. Remember that we are doing piecewise identification, which means that we are kind of identifying the shocks within only the Italian shocks at once, and then we move and identify the Spanish shocks, and then so we are not able, because there are just too many restrictions and it would be impossible to show that. We are working on a robustness check where to show that we can identify 4 shocks in the same time, meaning in 2 countries, and show that there's not so much difference when we identify, when we do the piecewise identification. ACB, for example, I'm going to skip this one quickly. So a conventional monetary policy proxy, which is basically the marginal refinancing operations interest rate. The spread between EONIA and marginal refinancing rate is the liquidity proxy, and the annual delta log of ACB balance sheet is our proxy for unconventional monetary policy. So we have 3 types of policies by the ACB. We are adding now a proxy for inflation and a proxy for economy at the euro area level, in order to have some kind of reaction function by the ACB. Shortly, this is what we see here with how the ACB reacts to different uncertainty shocks, because somehow we know that our uncertainty shocks are kind of identified. We can look at how ACB is reacting to them. And we see that conventional monetary policy usually marginal refinancing operations rate in reaction to mainly key shocks. You see the red here are usually significant. Liquidity goes up in reaction to keys, and it's faster and more persistent, and it's more persistent in reaction to EPU shocks. Okay, so to some extent, what you take out from these two is that ACB had conventional monetary tools and liquidity instruments in order to react to financial uncertainty shocks. So to some extent, these things are kind of automatic, right? You have some kind of system in place, such as to react to financial shocks, which spread much faster from one country to another one. And you have liquidity. You increase liquidity almost automatically. You have the minimum refinancing operations, which also kind of you drop it quite fast. But where you probably have to invent yourself and come up with more interesting measures is in reaction to policy uncertainty shocks. And this is what we see, that the response to policy uncertainty shocks is when it comes to unconventional monetary policy. So the unconventional monetary policy was performed in reaction to policy uncertainty shocks rather than financial shocks. So by splitting these two types of uncertainty, we are thinking that we can be quite confident in claiming that unconventional measures were designed to mitigate policy uncertainty from spreading, right, across countries, while ACB reactions to financial uncertainty was somehow more faster and automatic and tackled based on the two kind of policy measures. So this is our backtesting. We are picking up some kind of outliers in our shocks, in the time series of the shocks. And for example, here you see that, in fact, we have a story about the consolidation of the Italian banking sector when there was some kind of, in the early 2005, Unicredit, the Italian largest bank, announced takeover of HVB Group, Germany's second biggest bank, and then basically Unicredit expanded, and some other takeovers in that spring 2005. So we see here, in fact, that that was a good news for the Italian financial sector, right? Consolidation would give the Italian financial sector a bigger presence in Europe. So in fact, it was, this is not only the largest shock within Italy, but it's also the largest shock across all possible similar shocks in other countries, which are depicted here with gray. Another example is Catalonia's independence referendum in 2017. You see here that this policy uncertainty in Spain is not only the biggest one in Spain, but also the biggest one across similar shocks and also across all the other shocks that we can identify in the system, right?
Can I have a question, Catalin?
Yes.
When you are saying that, okay, what you have in Spain is also like the biggest, the shock is the highest also across all the other countries, but isn't it by the identification scheme?
Yes, I mean, but we are, yes, the identification.
This is the result of the identification. This is how you identify the shock. I mean, it's the highest across all the countries.
Yes, it's the highest across all the countries, right.
Okay.
But what we are trying to say here is that there is a story, and there is a credible story for why this shock. You see, you are looking like basically, look, you are looking here basically 6 months, I guess, back and forth. So there is no shock except this here, like 6 months after. There is no shock bigger than, you know, within.
Yeah, okay, here, okay.
There is no bigger shock. And so what is the story? The story is the Spanish independence. Now, from what you recall, Mihai, was it any other shock within plus minus 6 months that was as big and as important as that?
In 2011, there were many of them. I don't know. They were like Greece.
That was 2017, Mihai. That was
2017. Okay, the one.
Right. So to some extent, we are trying to say that's why we put like in the middle, you have the shock, and then you are looking back and forth plus minus 6 months. So, you know, when we are talking about this kind of consolidation, takeovers, and so on, everyone in Italy know here the Bancopoli event, and that they were trying, and what Banca d'Italia tried to move in the scandal. So they all know somehow that that was the biggest event happening within some kind of months before and after that. So, you know, I see my shock as an outlier in the system, right? And then, so I can ask myself, what was happening in that country within that particular month, right? So can I identify, can I find a story that somehow matches the sign and, if you want, the magnitude of the shock? And of course, you can do many exercises like that. Many people in many papers are doing that, you know, when they are using, for example, external instruments to identify.
But what I was trying to do is like to put them, you kind of presented them like in reverse order, but the right order is like you have an identification scheme at each period of time. You find a maximum in absolute value shock that belongs to a certain country, which is a maximum across all the countries for each period.
Yes.
And then exactly. You go and you see what happened in that country.
These are all normalized.
Yeah, yeah,
shocks,
yeah.
Normalized, okay. To be on the same scale.
Yeah, yeah.
But for sure, that shock is the biggest one. So then, can I find a story that basically matches
exactly.
The sign,
yeah.
Right? For that, yeah. For that country? Because then I'm kind of basically exposing myself. Look, you can look anywhere on Bloomberg and trying to find me another story for June 2005 that was, you know, as significant for the financial sector as this one. You know, and I think that basically we are exposing ourselves. These are the event, and somehow our system, our model, identifies this as the single biggest event within our sample. So you can go and find for another policy event. Look, there is no other event in other countries here which is bigger than this one in Spain here, right? So maybe you find something here 3 months before. You see here some gray here, which seems to be going to minus three. Okay, this is like two something. Okay, okay. So robustness checks, we are doing this. This is ongoing. We are using the yields levels instead of yield spreads. And the different weighting metrics, adding a liquidity in order to rule out liquidity as a driver uncertainty shock. And lastly, conclusions. We think that these findings are interesting, and you can identify uncertainty shocks that match some historical patterns in the data. And what we see, I'm going to just spend a bit of time on these two results, that there is some, seems to be some kind of amplification mechanism, because KISS responding to EPU is kind of amplified outside the country of origin. So you can say that uncertainty shocks get blurred if they cross the borders. And the second one, it's more related to the policy. So given that we have COVID and we have so many uncertainties in the euro area, is it like possible or likely that the European Central Bank is unable to exit from its quantitative easing? Because we've seen that basically quantitative easing was done in response to policy uncertainty. So you can claim that as long as there is policy uncertainty preventing, and you can think about inflation coming, about the joint sovereign bonds issuance by the European Commission. So all these kind of, nobody knows where we're gonna end up. So all these policy uncertainty prevailing maybe would force European Central Bank to stick to its quantitative easing. You know, that could be like kind of a policy implication from the results. I'm more curious to find out what you think about the paper and about the amplification mechanism rather than the policy implications of the paper. So I'm just looking forward to hear your feedback and questions.
Okay. O să revin la limba română. Mulțumim mult, Cătălin, pentru prezentare. Super interesant. Dacă sunt întrebări, le puteți adresa fie în română, fie în engleză. Nu e nicio restricție și vă rog să faceți asta.
Salut, pot începe eu dacă mă auziți.
Da.
Mie mi s-a părut foarte interesant, chiar cred că e folositor. Și mă gândeam, de exemplu, dacă ai putea să ne explici puțin din punct de vedere al datelor, de ce n-ai putut să incluzi în analiză România, în afară, adică excluzând EPU data, despre care ai spus că nu sunt disponibile nici pentru Ungaria, Cehia. Care exact a fost dificultatea pentru care n-ai putut să bagi România în analiză? Cred că ar fi util pentru noi.
Trebuia, practic, ca să introduci o țară în modelul ăsta, îți trebuie nu neapărat cele trei variabile endogene, ci inclusiv să găsești date despre ceea ce se numește portfolio exposures de la Deci datele referitoare la această matrice de weights, de, de ponderi. Nu? Și din câte știu eu, datele nu erau foarte ori nedisponibile, ori erau pe un sample foarte scurt de la FMI. Aceste date sunt de la FMI. Și atunci, dacă nu am date foarte mult, nu pot să calculez ponderea cu care România e expusă față de celelalte țări. Ci trebuie un anumit nivel, pentru că altfel, dacă e foarte volatil, nu știu, poate cu un anumite, cu anumite drawbacks ar putea fi inclusă și România, să fiu sincer. Dar la momentul acela, acum 2 ani când colectam datele, la momentul acela România nu avea niște date, din păcate. Dar încă o dată, eu cred că poate fi aproximat, adică aici nici măcar nu, deși în paper sunt, aici am statele Baltice, cum răspund, am Polonia, adică modelul produce foarte multe rezultate, în orice caz. A avea România sau nu aici, nu știu dacă ar, adică are o însemnătate pentru cei care sunteți acolo. Înțeleg asta, dar din punct de vedere al rezultatelor modelului, noi încercăm să găsim acele pattern-uri în rezultate care se repetă, indiferent de ce date folosesc sau ce variante folosesc. Cu alte cuvinte, aici dacă aș fi observ, dacă observ că pentru Polonia e pozitiv și că spillover rule are o contribuție semnificativă, nu mă interesează atât de mult să știu că e pozitiv pentru Polonia și negativ pentru țările baltice. Pe mine mă interesează să văd ceva robust care se repetă, e sistematic în toate, în toate rezultatele. Deci, cred că valoarea adăugată e aici mai degrabă decât în a vedea ce rezultate obții pentru o anumită țară, aș zice eu.
Da.
Da, din păcate aș fi vrut să includ România, dar la momentul ăla nu s-a putut. Acela nu s-a putut.
Mersi mult.
Aș fi curios pentru legătură cu mecanismul de amplificare, dacă vi se pare foarte clar sau dacă vedeți intuiția acestui mecanism sau dacă rezultatele sunt prezentate într-un fel care să conducă la un astfel de, o astfel de explicație care e teoretic în linie cu acele modele teoretice, cum că informația, există information frictions și e destul de greu nu să traduci o știre din Italia și să o traduci în Germania. Nu despre asta e vorba. Da, e posibil să fie și vorba despre anumite relații, anumite zvonuri, anumite informații care nu sunt încă în piață, dar care sunt cumva reflectate în media și care sunt mai greu preluate în media, dacă vreți, din afară.
Ok, hai că încerc eu să zic ceva.
Te rog.
Mi se pare din perspectiva asta cumva modelul, parcă îi lipsesc o serie de variabile, mi se pare prea simplu. Îmi dau seama că la GVAR ai problema asta chiar mai amplificată decât la VAR de a estima masiv numărul de parametri. Și aici vreau să te întreb în ce măsură nu te-ai gândit la... nu știu, să folosești mai degrabă ceva Bayesian GVAR, că sunt și astea și cumva ai putea să treci de partea asta de dimensionalitate, pentru că la început când ai prezentat și corelațiile acelea cross countries și cross indicators, cumva spuneai că e o problemă de stabilitate în timp.
A corelațiilor,
dar atunci, da. Mă gândesc că se transferă cumva, nu știu, ai făcut și un rolling window să vezi cum se schimbă estimările, dacă le fac. Poftim?
Nu, rolling window, cum se schimbă estimările, nu, n-am făcut,
Da,
dar
mă gândeam
corelați.
că na, e un prior a face chestia asta dacă să treci pe Bayesian sau nu. Și din perspectiva asta,
E posibil, nu zic, nu.
mă gândesc că poate ai putea să adaugi chiar tu spui în anumit, cred că la robustness, la partea că te gândeai să adaugi inflație și.
Dar, Mihai, trebuie să te gândești că toate aceste variabile sunt high frequency. Ok? Inflația și producția industrială sunt mai slow moving variables și ele oricum sunt adăugate, dar doar la nivelul întregii Uniuni. Adică ele cum ar veni sunt adăugate în
În
modelul.
external, da?
Exact, sunt cumva adăugate în modelul BCE-ului. BCE-ul funcționează ca o carte, ca o țară în plus, ca o țară virtuală, artificială. Și țara asta artificială, care cum ar veni doar primește informații, da, și reacționează într-un fel prin cele trei variabile, primește informații legate de incertitudine, de yield-uri și reacționează inclusiv în funcție de inflație și producția industrială la nivelul. Dar producția industrială și inflația le-am adăugat la sugestia unor reviewers, dar după mine sunt slow moving variables, adică ele cum ar veni îmi clean the data un pic, deci îmi elimină anumite explicații, dar nu sunt la frecvența aceea înaltă pe care o au datele mele de incertitudine și de yield-uri. Adică acolo mă uit cum ar veni la un alt orizont. Dar, într-adevăr, Bayesian G-var ar putea fi o variantă. Nu ne-am gândit la asta. Dar, sincer, eu aș încerca să, cum ar veni, să expun și să prezint mai mult părțile bune ale. În loc de metoda de estimare. Metoda de estimare, ok, trebuie să ai anumite constrângeri, anumite limitări, dar aș încerca să scot în față rezultatele. Adică, până la urmă, e un model ca oricare altul, care e destul de eficient în a, încă o dată, în a elimina acea componentă comună din toate variabilele, astfel încât, până la urmă, să fii sigur că identifici acele elemente specifice unei țări. Da?
Înțeles. Din punctul ăsta de vedere, cumva revenind la întrebarea ta inițială, într-adevăr, partea teoretică, adică și în prezentare, dar și în lucrare, conexiunea nu e foarte clară cu un stream teoretic
Exact.
bine definit. Adică, nu știu, poate te-ai uitat sau nu pe paper-uri de genul care au cross-border lending, Shin și alții în care
Exact.
cumva expunerile astea ale, nu știu, băncilor europene în Statele Unite și invers duc la mecanismul ăsta de amplificare. Cred că Sheen are un paper în care spune că, de fapt, una din cauzele nu mai știu, amplificării crizei, nu știu, dar poți să-ți trimi referința exact, dacă
Ok,
vrei.
mersi. Mersi, ideea e
E ideea de
că
amplificare, cumva, și atunci asta trebuie
Ideea de
modele cu
aici.
cross-border lending sau cu expuneri cross-border din
Exact.
partea
Dar
de banking.
ideea e că tu, din afară, nu poți să pui degetul exact pe și să interpretezi corect un șoc. Tu vezi niște consecințe afară, dar nu știi exact care e originea acelui șoc. Prin urmare, automat, reacția ta de aversiune la risc e mult mai puternică. Și din cauza asta, în tabel, de regulă, aceste reacții cross-border sunt uneori semnificative, pe când ele nu sunt semnificative înăuntru unei țări. Da? Adică sistemul și modelul identifică cum ar veni un singur șoc care rămâne persistent într-o țară. Deci, pentru cei de acolo, ei înțeleg că e un șoc de finance și acel șoc rămâne persistent. Corect. Ce se întâmplă cu cealaltă variabilă nu contează, ea rămâne nesemnificativă. În schimb, în afară, reacțiile sunt semnificative uneori în ambele variabile de incertitudine. Și asta nu se poate explica foarte ușor. Adică, de ce în țara respectivă separarea e clară, iar în afară, cum ar veni, e neclară.
Okay.
Nici nu există modele teoretice cu două tipuri de incertitudine sau cu risc și incertitudine.
Ai risc și ambiguitate.
Ok, dar și inclusiv cross-border?
Nu.
Deci poți să ai cross-border lending și poți să ai un tip de incertitudine, dar nu știu dacă există modele cu două tipuri de incertitudine și cross-border lending.
Da, asta nu știu.
Care cum ar veni să nu... Există acest paper al lui Freixas and Holthausen, care e destul de vechi și care face o separare între financial integration și financial segmentation. Da? Deci, dar acolo, într-un fel, se devină pe information frictions, care duc la două tipuri de echilibre, dar information frictions, eu aș putea să le interpretez ca diferența între policy și financial uncertainty, dar nu pot să-l interpretez ca un singur șoc de incertitudine. Deci pot să-l interpretez ca... Adică pot să presupun că finance uncertainty se răsfrânge imediat, pe când policy uncertainty se răsfrânge mult mai greu. Asta da, aș putea să fac. Și atunci aș fi exact în framework-ul descris de Freitas și Holthausen.
Ideea e că o să fie foarte greu să-l publicați undeva sus fără un model teoretic și ești conștient de asta în spate.
Da, sunt conștient de asta, dar sunt și jurnale care publică efectiv.
Applied. Da.
Da, sunt în contact cu un alt coautor, poate devenim trei la un moment dat, nu știu exact, și adăugăm eventual un de intuiția acestui model din punct de vedere teoretic.
Da, nu știu, ceva simplu, poate poți să faci ceva two periods, cross-country și cumva cu un mecanism de asta de amplificare exact. De la unul.
Exact. Modelul deja are, paper-ul are deja foarte multe referințe și va trebui foarte mult tăiat și scurtat dacă adăugăm un framework teoretic. Așa că va fi multă muncă, pentru că deja e la limită pentru anumite jurnale, ca dimensiune. Da, sunt conștient de lucrurile astea.
Ok? Alte întrebări?
Ok, sper că v-a plăcut, okay. Că l-ați găsit interesant, un pic cam model heavy și data heavy, dar e încă mult de muncă, dar cred că are ceva care... și într-adevăr, voi acum în România aveți un policy uncertainty, nu? Pentru voi e destul de clar ceea ce se întâmplă, dar poate pentru alții din afară nu e atât de clar și... E posibil să, nu? Să vândă active românești și să, adică pentru ei să fie o reacție, o aversiune la risc mult mai generalizată, să nu facă diferența. Ok, nu ne interesează. Pentru voi probabil că ar fi destul de clar că ok, e o criză care se va
sfârși. S-au obișnuit și ei.
Pentru voi poate e destul de clar că e o criză care se sfârșește într-o săptămână și atunci, nu știu, poate ăsta home bias, nu? Poate ai putea să te uiți la reacția investitorilor locale față de reacția investitorilor străini pentru a înțelege dacă e o diferență între cum reacționează străinii și românii la un șoc de policy față de un șoc de finance uncertainty. O să caut și paper-uri pe chestia asta să le... Nu?
Da, poate să fie... Dacă mă gândesc să-ți dau un răspuns să... Cred că, având în vedere ce s-a întâmplat în ultimii 2-3 ani sau poate chiar în ultimii 15 ani, cred că s-au obișnuit și străinii și s-a estompat diferența asta de reacție care probabil era la un moment dat. Cred că s-au obișnuit și ei. Bine, asta nu înseamnă că lipsește o reacție, doar că nu mai e atât de diferită asta. Vreau să zic.
În mod clar, în afară, ceea ce se întâmplă în România e foarte greu preluat. Adică dacă nu ai un interes între a urmări lucrurile în România, foarte rar citesc în Italia știri despre România, de exemplu. Chiar în presa de specialitate, adică presa financiară.
Da. Am pus un link la paper-ul acela de spuneam.
Ah, okay.
Mulțumim mult, Cătălin.
Plăcere.
Mulțumim mult pentru
Sper să ne vedem cât de curând la o altă conferință. Sau chiar și în afara conferințelor.
da.
De-abia aștept să elimine restricțiile și să trec prin, să ajung în țară. Am ajuns vara asta, dar foarte puțin, 3-4 zile.
Cu drag,
Ok,
doresc.
atunci o
Mulțumim,
după-amiază plăcută, vă doresc.
Cătă, la fel.
Mulțumim, să ne vedem cu bine.